the people. Because the people got the power. Tell me, can you hear it? It's getting stronger by the hour. Power!
It's the Playboy interview.
Evening, Darren.
How you doing? You all right?
Not bad. Thanks for taking the time to have a chat. You're a very interesting character, and that's why we've took the time out to put this presentation together, just so we can get a general idea. Can you just give us a bit of an idea of your background? You know, a lot of people say, don't they, that get involved in our sphere of things, for a loose sort of term, the truth movement.
Yeah.
Which is a catch-all sort of term, isn't it?
It involves.
Involves so
conspiracy
much.
Theorists, right up to the edge of politics.
It does. And a lot of people say that they have a moment in their life where there's a switch that's flicked and they think, blimey. And that's when they can point to when they first got interested in truth, for want of a better term. Have you got that, really? Because as far as I'm aware, that you were a musician right from the off, but you were a sort of a musician that liked to have a message, didn't you?
Yeah, I was always socially conscious. There was a coming together a couple of years ago of all these confluences throughout my life. But I was always writing songs. I'd write a few love songs, but I was always writing songs about what I thought was social, to bad songs, by the way, but about social injustices and all the rest of it. So I was always rooting for the underdog, and I was hating injustice, and I never understood war as a kid or anything like that. So I was always aware, but not the fact that it was coordinated, the fact that there are serious evil plans behind it, that secret societies are being manoeuvred and controlled, that we've all been indoctrinated and educated. I mean, when you see it, you see it, and there is that moment. But for me, it was all kinds of awakenings all at once.
So you were in a band, you were a musician, you were gigging, you were doing all the things that young people in bands like to do.
Yeah.
But you, at the same time, you were putting across a message of, you know, hope, freedom, perhaps, you know, change.
Yeah, probably. If I look back, I have no idea what any of those songs are.
So you progressed that, didn't you? Probably to things like where you thought, right, things are wrong. I'm a musician, so I'll use the talent I've been given to, you know, put that message across.
The decision to, like everybody else, I was in the world. I was working in sales, doing horrible things like selling credit cards and gas and electric and all the rest of it. At the end of 2011, I'd got ripped off once again by another weasel guy, a couple of guys, and that made my decision to fully be a musician. I mean, properly be a musician. I'd worked in dance music as well. It was nearly 20 years since I released my first dance record. So you know, without ever having any huge success, but it didn't make a difference to me. I was happy to, and I still am. I'm happy to just play for an appreciative audience. Now, the difference between where I thought I was in my head, and this is true for every single person on the planet, but there was a difference where I was in my head and where I actually was, talent and performance and everything else wise and knowledge wise, was vast. So I spent the next year learning songs and sitting down and kind of treating it as a job every day. So 2012, when the big 21st of December 2012, the big main thing, the big prophecy came out, I remember I was on Facebook And I was taking the piss. I wrote a post in the morning going, I've sold all my possessions, I'm stood naked on the roof of my house, I'm waiting for the end of the world, and you know what I mean? It's 3 o'clock, and where are they, and all the rest of it. And it wasn't 4 months later that my friend said to me, you know the Bank of England's a private company, right? It was just the right time, the right place. And really? And then, I don't know if it was a few days or a few hours, a few days or a few weeks or whatever it was, but I just went through the lot, you know what I mean? And then, you know, the banking system with David Icke and the Illuminati, blah, you know, all the New World Order, the Agenda 21, vaccinations, mainstream media, all that stuff, bang. Because I had the free time to do it as well. I'd made the decision to organise my life so that I spent the whole year learning how to, so if nothing else, I could then go out and busk and what have you, and earn a bit of a living, no matter what, I've got that skill. Then you've got that. As it happens, I woke up. So those skills that I'd really been pushed to learn, been, you know, kind of motivated or spirited to learn or work on, I wanted to put them to use to, you know what I mean, help them get the message out. Because that's the thing, when everybody wakes up, and people hate this phrase and that phrase, but that's what it feels like. And if you've not had it, then you know, you should. You know, and it was only through intellectual logical search, if you like. It was only through finding out how things really work. What's the Federal Reserve, and how does money really? It was only through intellectual curiosity, if you like, that wakes you up. And part of the deception, I think, is the attacks on our health, the vaccinations, the fluoride, the trans fats and everything. That slows us down, it makes us apathetic. We're aware that kids are being raped and people are going hungry and wars are being waged and there's just a lot of unnecessary suffering. But part of the problem is that we are ingesting poisons that slow us down, make us apathetic, make us uncompassionate, make us scared, and make us feel that we're unable, both unwilling and unable, to do something about it. And that's the big difference. I've always hated it, I've always hated injustice, but never felt anything, never felt like, A, you could make a difference. And but by the way, quite clearly, one person can't make a difference. They're right in that. But you can't. One person can't make a huge difference, but you can make even a little difference. Every act of kindness counts, and doesn't matter how small it is. So if I do one thing for it. Because I realise that a homeless person is there because of the way the world is, not because of their own choices, or it might be a mix of the two, or well, there before the grace of God go I. Right? It's just genuine compassion for a brother or a sister that is down on their luck, rather than should get a job, loser. You know what I mean? Like this separateness that we're taught, this isolation that we're taught, we're one family. We're family. So, how anybody can, treat, and I want them professing to be, you know, religious, and it's not just Christians. People have got Christians who are selfish and uncompassionate, and that's fair enough. But there's a lot of New Age truthers who don't want to discuss who don't want to help the homeless, or don't want to go on anti-child abuse rides, or even talk about it or share the information, because it's an icky subject. It's too cheap. If you ignore the negative, it'll go away. Well, that's not what's happening to those in Guantanamo Bay. We're ignoring the hell out of that, and guess what? People are still illegally and, they haven't been convicted of anything for sure. In fact, the American authorities have declared them a couple of years ago completely innocent of all charges, except Donald Rumsfeld has come out and said, well, we can't let them go now because obviously we've been torturing for the last 10 years, so they're going to hate us. Mm. So they're now dangerous. The insanity of the world needs pointing out, and that, I think, is my job. And I thank God that I spent that year, and really my whole life, kind of learning the guitar. Like I said, I did some dance music and all about production, but that's all irrelevant to me now. The fact that I can go out and raise spirits, or tell truth, or make people laugh, or do all those three things at once. Is my gift. It's the gift that was given, hasn't it?
And because you certainly you've raised the profile of things like Wake Up Manchester. You are the sort of focal point for that with your talent, with the guitar and your song.
There are a lot of other talented musicians, yeah. And extremely committed people that make that work.
Yeah, without shadow of a doubt. But you are sort of pivotal to it, because you know, your talent, your songwriting talent is there, and people can relate to it. The general public can relate to a catchy song, can't they? And a lot of your songs, you know, you might not agree with the content, but they're catchy.
Right.
You find yourself humming them, don't you?
Right.
So yeah, you've raised the profile of the fracking movement as well with your songwriting.
Early doors.
Definitely. So early doors. You know, so your talent as a musician has been, you know, put to good use.
Yeah, I hope so.
And that brought, you know, you were on my radar, you know, and you've become on the Truth Movement's radar because of your talent. You know, we haven't got that many talented people who could sort of plug into the mainstream,
right,
if you like.
What we're doing, yeah.
And what we're doing, because we're always seen, you know, sort of on the fringes of stuff, whereas you could sort of bring in people who maybe
I hope so.
So maybe not totally in our way of thinking, but they can relate to you
in
the stuff you're doing.
In whatever way it does.
So, you were having problems with your mortgage when you lived in Bury, I believe, and then you had conflict with the bailiffs, you put a shout out for assistance, and people from all over the Northwest came to your house in Bury.
They came even further than that.
To stop the eviction. And the video that we did from that day gone viral, hasn't it? It's been like nearly 250,000 people.
Is it that many now?
Yeah, it's
hopeless sinner, you ask, it's all mankind. Series on, believe me, one love. What about the one heart? One heart. What about the let's get together and feel alright? As it was in the beginning, one love, so shall it be in the end? One heart. Give thanks and praise to the Lord. Together and feel alright. One more thing, let's get together to fight this holy Armageddon.
Now down here, lads, back off. Go on, go home. Now down here, get a proper job.
Chuckle brothers.
Okay, I want to know your detail.
Who are you?
I want to know your details.
I'm not giving
you that. Can you show us the warrant? Your details.
Can you show us the warrant, please?
I think we've got a warrant for your arrest.
Can you show us the warrant, please?
Show us your documentation.
Can you show us the warrant, please? With a wedding signature.
Goodbye. Na 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 na. Na 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 na. Hey. Goodbye. Na 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 na. Na na na.
This is going to happen wherever you guys go from now on.
When they arrived?
All I saw, somebody said, oh, you know, they parked up, and I just had a shout, we locked the door, obviously, because I don't want them to steal my home. And as I was walking towards them, everybody just kind of shooed them down the road. That's it. That's all I basically saw. They've got back in the car, they've drove off, and it was like, you know, see you later. I haven't served any paperwork. I don't even know I'm assuming the bailiffs. They looked like, you know, I expect to be, but they weren't badged up, they didn't identify themselves to me, or I don't know if anybody else, but they basically just left. So I haven't seen any paperwork, haven't seen anything else. But the big thing for me is all these people, as I've just been saying off camera, all these people are here to show that, there's an uprising going on. We're not going to stand for it. We're going to stand together. Because I've been through the courts. I've tried it doing their way with the judge and all the rest of it. They have broken their own laws. They have purged themselves. None of them will listen. It's a tight, closed system. We know it involves child rape. It involves murder and war. And, you know, the worst crimes against humanity. Now, at the end of the day,
we don't be arrested in a dressing gown.
dressing gown. Sing it, we are a 99%. Sing it, we are a 99%. Sing it, we are a 90%. Together we are mighty. We are a 99%. When the chemtrails are all gone, there'll be blue skies when the chemtrails are all gone. There'll be blue skies when the chemtrails and their evil plan fails. Blue skies when the chemtrails are all gone. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 90%. Together we are mighty. We are the 99%. You can stick your damn eviction up your ass. You can stick your damn eviction up your ass. You can stick your damn eviction, cause we've got more conviction. Stick your damn eviction up your ass. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 90%. Together we are mighty. We are the 99%. You can stick your fracking drilling up your ass. You can stick your fracking drilling up your ass. Yeah. You can stick your fracking drilling. Install all and you're killing. Stick your fracking drilling up your ass. Up your ass. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 90%. Together we are mighty. We are the 99%.
What else can we stick on?
Oh, I'd rather be a hobbit than an orc. Oh, I'd rather be a hobbit than an orc. Oh, I'd rather be a hobbit. See bailiffs and stuff it. Rather be a hobbit than an orc. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 90%. Together we are mighty. You can stick your poison vaccines up your ass. You can stick your TV programs up your ass. You can stick your TV programs. So you ain't gonna go to school. Who wrote this song anyway? Stick your Georgia Guidestones up your ass. Singing, we are 99%. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 90%. Together we are mighty. We are the 99%. Oh, I'd rather be a human than a slave. Oh, I'd rather be a human than a slave. Oh, I'd rather be a human. And don't you know that you can rather be a human than a slave. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 99%. Singing, we are the 90%. Together we are mighty. We are the 99%.
That's first, that was the first.
You can stick your new world order up your ass. You can stick your new world order up your ass. You can stick your new world order where the sun don't shine but water. Stick your new world order up your ass.
Great day, it was a great show of solidarity. It was great raising awareness that the banks are entirely, they're running a system of debt money that is entirely, it's a crime against humanity, as we know. It's how they are enslaving us and have enslaved us. It involves price controls and all. I mean, the tentacles of it are huge. However, everybody should know that they should not follow in my footsteps and basically pick up the house and throw it at the powers that be, because they are set up to they're set up to take it off you. You can challenge them on debts, you can challenge them on bank debts and card, credit card debts, and even council tax to a certain extent. We don't know how that's going to go. It's a minefield, and people want something for nothing sometimes. So a lot of people will have seen that video and commenting on it and saying, well, you know, you should pay the mortgage and whatever. And they're right to a certain extent, because anybody that doesn't, they will come and take your house off you. And that message needs to be made absolutely clear. They don't rule by law, they rule by force. the real truth is houses should be a tenth or a twentieth of the price. Life should be very easy without the debt money and the control of the banking. And the idea to make human suffer, because the more you suffer, the more unhappy you are, the more miserable you're going to be, the less compassionate you're going to be, the less, you know.
It was great. It was great because that day it was energising. It was. It didn't matter about the result so much. It was the fact that we had people coming together. Might not agree on everything,
yeah,
but we're getting together to help someone,
yes,
who they had respect for, because you earned that equity through your work, through being a musician, right, and spreading the truth, and people can relate to that. They're, yeah, right, I'm going to help that fella. And so, yeah, so that was a great day, and it's good that you can admit that it might not have been a success.
Well, that day was very, very successful. It was a brilliant moment, and to be honest with you, similar actions have fought off more with renting, but have fought off unlawful or immoral evictions. So communities coming together is, it's not all negative. In other words, it is for me, right? It's great for, you know what I mean, us as a community, but, you know, and here's me saying, you know, don't be selfish, we have to think outside ourselves, be compassionate. But at the end of the day, if you're living on the streets, there is very little you can do. If you're struggling just to survive and just to get by and just to eat and just to get the basics, there is very little you can do to help others. You then become, you know, somebody that people need to help. So that's a, you know, again, that's everybody's decision to make, I suppose.
It was some time after that. You were on my radar. You were, someone I sort of got a lot of respect for. Thought this fella's doing the right thing. You know, he's using his talent to spread joy. I got a lot of respect for that. But I remember seeing a video of you being at a Reclaim the Power camp.
In Blackpool, right. Preston New Road, yeah.
And I remember seeing the whole, it was like something from the Stepford Wives, a whole lot of people coming towards you. You've got to go. You've got to go.
Oh my word. I'm stunned.
Hi, Dad, I'm Lou.
Hey, Liz, you alright?
Yeah, I'm alright.
Nice to meet you.
I personally would like to thank you for your dedication to Anti-Fracking work, because I'm an organiser from Pennsylvania.
Oh, okay, right.
And we're really, really suffering in Pennsylvania, and we...
Yeah, we know. Listen, Hobbs, of course.
Yeah, we definitely...
You guys inspired us apart from us.
Yeah,
and so... that's happening over here as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, and so we're really, really... I mean, I personally really, really appreciate the work that you and everyone has done to fight fracking here in the UK, and I think you guys are really going to win it here. But some people in the camp feel uncomfortable and would really feel more comfortable if you would call it quits to this weekend and just head out.
Why?
People feel uncomfortable and there's...
In what way do you feel uncomfortable? This is the only hassling that's going on right now.
Yes. I love that. It's not like this.
You don't need to defend me. It's okay. You know what I mean? But this is the only hassling that's going on right now.
Right, but there's
if I'm running around hassling people or fighting them or being drunk or whatever, that's annoying behaviour.
Which we didn't do.
You've all now come ganged up. You all ganging up on me now. This is the only hassling that's going on.
If you respect the community and the consensus that...
I've already said I'm not saying. Okay. I've already said I'm not saying. But I will not be hanging out by a flash mob or a potter.
It's not a flash mob,
because
it's just...
I have not committed any crime...
What is it then? Talk about intimidation?
Any other human or what have you. And I have no intention of doing that.
No one's saying that. We're just saying that...
What intimidation?
Right, well, also then you can understand that some people also feel... Even if you don't...
Is it any of you guys?
Other people feel
intimidated. Is it any of you guys? Let's talk. Is it you guys? Is it you guys that have actually come over? Is it you guys that have come over to actually speak? Are you feeling hassled?
We're not here to discuss.
Me and Kian have had things on. Are you feeling unsafe? Are you feeling actually unsafe? Or do you just don't agree? Just don't agree with what you think I am? Do you actually feel unsafe? You're smiling. You don't look unsafe.
I know what you are, Darren.
You know what I am.
We're all here because the camp has reached consensus.
I'm a nasty person.
We're not here to discuss it.
Okay.
We, some people don't.
uncomfortable, they may not be the people. It doesn't matter. If they feel uncomfortable, they don't want to.
Never known anything like this.
They don't want to confront you personally.
Okay.
Right. And you obviously don't. You respect the community and you care about anti-fracking work, and so there's no reason. And it's gonna rain tomorrow. The weather's gonna be shit anyway. So it's a great time.
They're upsetting the kids now.
Don't use that.
Right,
so anyway,
there's
no reason.
I won't be hounded out by people. Are you going to physically remove it?
We're all children here.
You're your own person.
Well, we'll just sit here chatting, minding our own business.
Okay, so there's children involved.
We're not asking anybody else.
We're going to withdraw a bit because I'm not upset. The children come first.
Yeah, my daughter's here and Kerry's son's here, and we're both very upset by this.
We're here as a group of consensus.
Yeah, I understand.
And you've been asked.
I understand why you're doing what you're doing.
Exactly.
And you can obviously see by my face.
Could you just let me speak, please? I'm just saying, we're going to back off now because there's children involved here and I don't want to distress any children. And we are here as a group.
Like the truth movement.
It was amazing to me because here we are, we're seeing people supposedly in our sphere of thinking had turned
on... I'd assume they'd heard of Bolton Moss. What? I'd been invited there. I'd been invited to come. People knew I was coming. They knew I was coming. As soon as we came in the place, somebody went... I'm saying nothing, I'm not getting involved. At that point, we kind of knew. So, what? I've come with my guitar, I play songs, I did, you know what I mean? I walked onto a field, I said hello to a few people, I got harassed, and then they brought all these people over. And then somebody who had stood on the line with a Barton Moss, he turned on me. And I just thought, this is the new world order here. Yeah? This is green. This is the one world green communism. It's all about the fracking and all the rest of it. Like I absolutely said, I'm pro fracking or kill all babies or whatever. You know what I mean?
Like, they'd obviously had a perception that in some way you'd broken ranks or you had some sort of heresy that you were, without actually
something to do with some Macau post on the cult of the hidden hand, the cult of the Illuminati, and apparently he'd also written on some homosexual issues, on how it's been genetically and socially engineered with estrogens and all the rest of it. And again, you know, there's obviously evidence to support that, otherwise I wouldn't say it. But from there, you're homophobic, and it's like saying women have a womb. And therefore, you know, when it's time for a couple or a family to have a baby and what have you, then, you know, the woman should have the baby, and, you know, obviously both should nurture where possible, but quite obviously women are biologically set up for that, whereas men aren't. We're, you know, stronger than others. But you're some kind of monster for saying, for speaking biology. This is, again, where the truth movement is not the truth movement at all, where liberals are not. You've not got free speech. Liberals you can have free speech as long as we agree with you. But it's a whole racing range of issues. And it always comes across as Pavlovian conditioning because of the venom and the anger and the barbs and the, you know what I mean, the serious hatred. It's strange
coming from people that supposedly.
Supposedly enlightened and connected.
Yeah, and free thinking and open to new ideas and perceptions.
Well, they're not open to new ideas at all. They just belong to a club. It's just a different club. It's not the club of we like the military industrial complex, or we like fossil fuels, or we like whatever, or we like, we like watching telly and Strictly Come Dancing, and we don't care about, you know, they're into the club of, yes, 9/11 vaccinations, or anti this or anti that or what have you. Everybody's just in a different club, and I've said from day one, if you like, that I'm not a member of anything. I don't belong to any group. I am after the truth. Does that make me a member of the truth movement? Not really, not if you act like that, because it's ironic again that conservatives sell everything off. Liberals don't want you to have any freedoms, but they want you to. They want to completely control this new agenda 2030, which, you know, it's going to be launched this September by the UN. Is showing exactly how, you know, it's the liberals, green environmentalist, wet dream, because it's control of everybody's life for sustainability. It's always sold as something good. It's always a deception. People that are selling the idea that we're going to be all RFID chipped against our will, or that they're going to come in with jackboots and machine guns and force everybody to do something. There already are armed police if you want to go and protest against the government or anything else. You know, if you want to hold serious opposition, then you'll see the armed police. But for most of the population, we won't see that, and you don't need it. You don't need any of that.
Is that, as I say, with the Reclaim the Power video, that put you on my radar specifically, because I have always got a great admiration for people that not narcissistic about it and deliberately, you know, fly in the face of whatever, but
the accusation's been levelled a few times.
But they're willing to, you know, speak their truth, or as they see it at the time. You know, things can be fluid and transient, but at the time they're willing, and despite the consequences. And that's when I first started to take an interest in the way you were going specifically. I started to take a notice of the things you were posting on Facebook and on social media. Mm. Again, coming under direct fire as a result. so we'll get on to that, if that's okay with you.
Okay.
Because initially, I saw you getting a lot of flack for was the fact that you didn't hide the fact that you were, in a loose sense of the word, a Christian.
That came after. Right. That come after the flat earth. And I kind of say I'm a Jewish Christian, so that you can include both books of the Bible. But the turning point was the end of the year, or this year, and I'd, up until then I'd kind of, you know, been part of that love and light type of thing and what have you, and it just run out, and I've never ever posted or done a thing, made a meme, whatever, that wasn't, wow, I'm really inspired to do it, yeah, like the most recent, the universe film caption one. I don't know if you saw it, I may have tagged you in it. If I'm inspired to do it, I'll do it. And if I'm not, then I'll leave it. So if I don't post for a few days or a week or whatever, it's because, you know, there's nothing there to get me. Same with writing songs. If there's one there to come, it'll come. If it doesn't, it doesn't. You don't really have to force it. And the turn of the year, all that stopped. It all dried up. And I wasn't worried for whatever reason. There was nothing there. Or I don't know what's going to happen now. You know what I mean? It's like, what's next? And what was next was obviously the fixed plane Earth, I like to call it, rather than the flat Earth, because flat Earth is, again, it's a phrase like conspiracy theory, and it's designed to speak to automatically switch the average person off.
So flat Earth came
before Bible.
So it came before the word of the Bible.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That's a strange sort of. Was that the flat Earth, or the idea of the we're living on a plane as opposed to a globe?
Yeah.
How did that become a catalyst, or were the two not related, that you found the word in the Bible? Is it?
Sorry, but I'm not following.
You say that you found the revelation that that the world might be flat or a plane as opposed to a globe.
Yeah.
And the idea that the we're living on a globe is a deception.
Yes.
Right. Did that lead to the Bible?
Yes.
Right. And how did it lead to it? What was the catalyst?
Well, because the Bible is a fixed earth book.
Right.
It's a state. It's a plane. It has corners. It mentions once that it's a circle, which we still haven't. You know, I mean, obviously not everything's complete yet. If we've got all knowledge, then we're, you know, what have you? But quite obviously, we've got loads to learn. The Bible is a fixed earth book. It kept coming up in the flat earth videos and articles that I was looking at, lots and lots of, okay, so, and once it was clear the earth is fixed and stationary, there's no universe out there, it's just the stars and the sun and what have you, basically the earth is the universe, if you like, I wanted to know, A, are there any other evidences that the Bible is true? Because that corresponds with the Bible. In other words, what I saw with my own senses corresponded. What other evidences are that the Bible is true? And then, what else does the Bible have to say about us today and what's going to happen next? Because We are quite clearly living in end times. That's why the truth movement exists. That's why the flat earth movement exists. That's why we're seeing what we're seeing now. You know what I mean? Because we know we're living in end times. And I don't think the world's going to end in this September. I don't think it's going to end in 2020. I don't know. Quite obviously, again, no man will know the day or the hour. It will probably happen in our lifetime, and we will see it probably next 20 or 30 years, certainly within a generation.
So let's backtrack a bit.
Okay.
I took you forward a bit there, but let's go back to this moment in time, if you can place it, where suddenly, blimey, the world's flat. Mm. Or did it happen like that, or was it a gradual thing? Did you find a few videos?
It took me 6 months.
Right.
It took me 6 months and three goes into it. So I understand the resistance to this idea, this concept. I perfectly understand it. Things didn't quite add up. Some things added up, some things didn't. And then look into it again. And I suppose around the turn of the year, it kind of finally dropped. The whole thing finally dropped for me. And for me, it's because a lot of people say, apart from the fact that it's a psyop, what does it matter what shape it is? We've got all these injustices that we've got to fight as well. We've got the paedophilia in the government and the fracking and the GMOs coming and the TTIP and all these things. And, you know, they're all completely and utterly irrelevant, but they're all wrapped inside this major, major deception. The shape of the Earth doesn't matter as much. What matters is the fact that there's no vast universe out there. There is only the Earth. And again, if people realise that, they would start acting more accordingly to that as well. It's the size of that deception, because you tell people that the Earth is fixed, it's stationary, and there's no universe out there, and they'll just laugh you out. The immediate reaction is to laugh and ridicule. And what, no matter where you stand on this debate, and let's face it, 99% of people are still with the mainstream and still with the indoctrinated model, they should at least admit that it isn't straightforward to prove that the Earth is a spinning globe. They might have this evidence and that evidence, but without NASA or CGI, which most truth movement and conspiracy theorists realise there's some serious wrong with the moon landings, you know, they're like the hoax of Mars. I've been pointing out you found coke cans and squirrels and all sorts on the shots of Mars. And recently they've had a big slew of Pluto, and then we've had a new shot of Earth, which has had sex clearly written in it upside down, like they do with the Disney films. And then we've had this new Earth-like planet from the Kepler telescope, and it seems like they're really ramping it up in the light of as well, in the light of people clearly waking up to this realization that the Earth is not spinning around us at all.
Okay, so you first looked into it, skeptical, I presume.
Yeah,
at
of
first.
Course.
I mean, you'd obviously seen
skeptical as everybody else, quite clearly. Flat Earth, yeah, right. Hang on a minute. Look, we've got fracking to worry about. We've got this to worry. Where is this coming from? It seems so left field. Don't forget, we've had 500 years of indoctrination. That's a lot of indoctrination. I mean, people go on about 9/11 and false flags and, you know, Muslim terrorists and this stuff. That's been going on for 20 or 25 years. This is 500 years. Every school child walks into a classroom for the first time, pretty nervous, but there's a globe there. There's a globe on the teacher's desk, or there's a map on the wall. But they're showing a video very straight away.
Well, there'll be a lot of people watching this video, perhaps because they're interested in you, or perhaps in the interest in the truth movement. They come across this video and they're saying, blimey, here's a high-profile truther, for want of a better term, who's put himself on the line, he's took on the bailiffs, he's put himself in Manchester to try and wake people up. Here he is, he's talking about a flat earth. What's this about? Now, so there must be, perhaps we can give some pointers to people watching this video. Why is the Earth? Why would you think that the Earth is?
Why do I believe that? Why do I no longer believe in the given model of the spinning ball?
Why would that happen?
There are so many anomalies. Like I say, if you take away NASA and CGI, and you know, funny enough, I went to stop another eviction in Oldham the other day, and as usual, I don't bring the subject up now, but the flat Earth came up. And the guy that was seriously questioning, seriously resistant, was clearly an intelligent guy and obviously scientifically trained, astronomer, or, you know, or all the rest of it. But then there's another guy, one of Russ's friends, who was obviously equally scientifically knowledgeable and astronomer and all the rest of it. And he basically said, yeah, I can, and this is a story I've seen so many times in the room, I came along and I thought, yeah, okay, here we go. Let me just quite clearly and easily prove the Earth is a spinning globe to these idiots who are going on and on about the flat Earth. Let me just get down to it. And he said 2 weeks later, oh my God, you know, all my previous beliefs have gone out the window. I cannot prove that the Earth is a globe. And it's the same for everybody else. The one that started off for me was there's no video of the spinning globe Earth in space. That was one of the real keys that really moved my thinking on a bit. Hang on a minute. There's a few still shots, although they were quite, you know, until recently, until 2012, they were pretty rare shots of Earth.
Composite pictures.
Always composite. Why? There's loads of satellites up there. We're going on all these missions all the time, space shot. Why are there loads and loads of shots of Earth? They don't have to be perfect. Let's see some blurry ones. Let's see some not quite right. Let's see some not perfect ones. That'd do me. That's when you know between real and fake. Like, same with music, funny enough. You hear the pop, the polished pop, and it's all auto-tuned voice, and it's all in key, and like, it doesn't sound real. It sounds fake. It sounds counterfeit. You hear me or any other, you know, busker on the streets and what have you, and they're singing the heart out. There's a difference between that and real. Well, it doesn't have to be a singer, by the way. It can be, you know, somebody playing violin or any kind of music. But real music makes a difference. And it's the same. It's the same with what seeing the NASA CGI, the pictures and the photos, and the amateur weather balloons. Watch videos of the amateur weather balloons going up. Yeah, they use GoPro fisheye lens, so the horizon actually does this and this and this. And when it straightens out, you can see it's flat. Now, if it was curved, it wouldn't ever, ever look flat, no matter what kind of lens you're using. And the horizon is always at eye level. It never drops. If you're on a ball, at some point as you rise, the horizon goes down and down and down and down, and it should be underneath you at some point as you rise, but it never is. All the shots are from the ISS, was supposedly 250 miles up, but the same as from 100 miles up or 50 miles up. They're all they all look the same. It's easy to fool people if they want to believe. I want to believe in outer space. I want to believe in other planets. Do you want to believe in a vast universe? You want to believe in Star Wars and spaceships and possibly aliens? Because this life seems so pointless and confusing and frustrating. People like us who see the truth, see what's going on, see how it's being manipulated, want to do something about it, and, you know, quite clearly we need more numbers, and those numbers aren't coming, are they?
Not really. This all opens up a can of worms, though, doesn't it? Because it creates so many questions. First of all, that it suggests that there's a massive deception taking place, mm-hmm. by a small percentage of the planet that want this kept a secret. They are aware of the truth.
Mm-hmm.
So why would they do that, do you think?
Why are they trying to deceive us? It's to do with, again, it's like I say, it's the idea that there is life on other planets. Now, I don't know. Many that study the conspiracy theories and follow it through and come across people like, oh, it's to say the guy before Serge Monast who came out with Project Blue Beam, William Cooper.
Bill Cooper.
Yeah. William Bull Cooper. Genuine guy. The genuine guys and the truth, the genuine leaders seem to be killed off in silence. People say, well, why aren't you dead yet? Well, I'm sorry, but I'm not. I don't have that kind of reach. I don't have a radio show that reaches, you know, and all the rest of it. It's better, to be honest, for kooks and what have you to be left there, because they know if you stop or silence or murder somebody or what have you, then serious questions are asked by ordinary people, aren't it? So sorry, get back to the point again.
Yeah, so there's a deception. So there's obviously this deception taking place, this power elite, for want of a better term, this cabal that control this planet.
Yeah,
know the reality.
Yes,
they control the space. They control NASA.
Who can go up there? Yeah, who can go up really high?
Yeah, so,
absolutely.
So yeah, like I said, there's obviously a reason. Like you say, that
to make us feel insignificant, isn't it?
Yeah.
is to make us be random. There's no purpose to your life. There's no God. There's no God who loves you. You're just a random. It goes hand in hand with evolution. Heliocentrism, the Big Bang, evolution. Something came out of nothing. Yeah. And the universe is, there's a massive universe, and the Earth is one of trillions of planets, and there's probably life on billions and billions of other ones. So you're not special. Nobody's special. The whole family isn't special, and neither are you special. So you know what I mean. Evolution, which again, evolution can only work if you've got these billions of years and this vast universe. Again, if the Earth is just the Earth, and we've got stars going rotating and the sun going east, you know, and all the rest of it.
Because there are those that believe that the Earth is flat, yet we're still in a universe. There are still planets. It's just that we're not a globe. We're just a flat rock in space. Oh. There are people like that. You know, not everyone is.
Do they say the flat rock is spinning? No, or is it still?
It's just still.
Not everyone is on board with
the Earth being a flat plane with a firmament
right
above, and right. The stars and the moon, and
there's lots of different variations.
And the sun are just basically nonsense being there to. It's not. They're not what we think they are, to be honest.
Right.
Now, so there is probably two schools of thought, isn't there? There's probably a lot of schools of thought.
I think there are a lot of different variations on the model.
So,
I think the person who says, I know the whole thing, is a fool.
Right.
I think anybody that does that is a fool. And even...
But what's interesting about you, God, specifically,
okay,
is, and what's made you interesting, is the fact that you marry the two. You marry the word from the Bible
right
with the flat earth.
Right.
You marry the two.
There's a fair few people that do that. There are lots of flat earthers that don't believe the Bible. There are far more people who believe the Bible who still think the Earth is a good
thing. To try and nail you down a bit.
Yeah.
What's it about? Why?
Hang on.
So, is this?
I don't know.
Are we a giant petri dish in which this deity that we call, for want of a better term, we call God, is experimenting or on us to see how we react to certain situations? What's going on?
I don't have the answers, and I don't pretend to. People have to find out for themselves, and that's always going to be the advice. Research it for yourself. Why do I believe the Bible is true? Number one reason is because I've always known all my life that the Earth, I mean, whenever I sat outside, I've never thought, oh, we're spinning around. You know what I mean? I've never ever thought that. I just didn't realise that was in opposition to the heliocentric solar system model that we've all been given. Hang on a minute, I am supposed to be spinning around, that's not the case. It's truth coming out, isn't it? It's because we are taught to lie to ourselves all our lives in everything we do. And that's the waking up process. You no longer accept lies from yourself. Yeah, that's not true. If I tell a lie, I feel bad about it. I mean, really bad about it. I'm talking about white lies, by the way. You know what I'm saying? Even if you lie about the age or something like that. But obviously, it goes deeper with the deep philosophical questions about life and who you are and what the hell you're doing here. We no longer accept wishy-washy, unproven theories, unsubstantiated. We need to see evidence for ourselves. And that's the difference now. Sorry, I've got off track again. What's the question?
Well, I suppose the point I'm trying to make is if you're marrying the two, which I suppose you are doing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Right? The Bible is prophetic in many ways.
It's three things. It's prophetic. It's a history. It's poetry and instruction, obviously. And absolutely prophecy. The books of Daniel, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, and... quite famously Revelation, Isaiah's a big one, and Revelation are the prophetic ones that everybody should take note of, because there are, you know, it's called Revelation, it's not called Apocalypse is the revealing, it's called Revelation. God is revealing, it's revealing the whole lot to us. Isn't that how a great book should work, or a great work should work? There's all kinds of going through, there's action, there's this, there's betrayal and murder and, you know, every single kind of thing, everything in there, and then right at the end you've got the Danian one, you've got the bit that ties it all together,
and reveals, and virtually every single bit of revelation is kind of, it relates back to every other book and every other chapter and every other verse in the Bible. So I was asking, the reason why I believe, and the reason why I'm going on about the Bible now, as opposed to I wouldn't have dreamed about that a year ago, is because A, the earth is fixed, B, there's a guy called Jonathan Gray, who's an archaeologist and a diver, and you should look up his YouTube called On the Sea Will Tell. He discovered, right where there should be, chariot wheels, horses' hooves and rib cages under the Red Sea, exactly where the Egyptians were drowned when Moses parted the Red Sea. So there's evidence for that story being true. There's also evidence that the fossil record in rocks and strata, and again you should really look at Walter B for this, his Genesis Conflict series is brilliant, but all that is actually evidence of a worldwide universal instantaneous flood. If you've got trilobites, everybody knows what trilobites are, they're supposed to be 540 million years old. You've got trilobites perfectly encased in mud. These things lived in the sea. If you die in the sea, yeah, you dissolve and disintegrate, and all the animals, all the creatures, you know, eat you very, very quickly. It died preserved. You've got fossils of fish with other fish in the mouths. That must have died instantly. All these things died instantly to have been preserved by that. Yeah, everything else deteriorates and decomposes, so we wouldn't have those, you know, millions of years old. There's problems with all of, and what I call capital science TM. There's problems with theoretical science. You can look at any kind of evidence, whether it's archaeology or experiments or what have you, and draw a zillion different conclusions from it. And we have problems when we draw the conclusions from it. The science, the numbers are the numbers, but they can be interpreted in lots of different ways. So and
dinosaur fossils.
Dinosaur fossils, you know, is it DNA? The carbon dating. Carbon dating can only be done accurately within a maximum of 100,000 years. So how do they know something was 65 million years old when they openly admit carbon dating cannot be accurate past 100,000 years? You tell me. I have another problem with. I've seen, you know, dinosaur bones, and there were obviously big creatures about, but are you telling me they were all meat eaters and they had tiny little arms? They were bigger than elephants, they had tiny little arms, all these ferocious teeth, must have clumped about, and they've got to catch these gazelles and, you know, really whippy animals somehow, you know what I mean? It's just one of their legs. They must have been the worst predators in the world. Have we got the golden standard has to be, do you have evidence? Do you have personal evidence? Is there archaeological evidence, genuine evidence? Is there reliable witness testimony? Those are the only things we can go off. They need corroborating. To say, I theorise about gravity, I theorise that the apple falls because of a force, a mysterious force that nobody's since proved, in hundreds of years, that gravity pulls the apple to the floor, rather than the fact that the apple, it has a greater mass density, a greater mass density than the air molecules below it, but not as great as the flat ground that's going to stop it. And that just makes that's a complete explanation of why the apple falls. Forget gravity. It's only needed if you're in a spinning ball that's going around a solar system to somehow keep us in. Without that, if you're just on a nice fixed earth plane and we don't know the shape of it, and there's plenty of other questions about it yet that nobody knows the answers to yet, then gravity is not needed. Like you fill up a balloon with helium, it will float off, won't it? What's gravity got to do with it?
So
Tina Turner should have made that song. So in fact, I've got a cover coming up.
Just for a second, let's just try and encapsulate what you just said.
Okay.
That prior to this deluge, this flood,
yeah,
that all cultures and religions have taught happen.
Yeah.
All of them.
Yes, you know, yes, yes. All cultures, it's not religions, it's all peoples around the world, all nations.
So yeah. Prior to this deluge,
right,
there existed, possibly existed, large creatures, huge creatures, that we now know as the dinosaurs.
Yeah. I think the book calls them Leviathans.
Leviathans and stuff. And then you've got the dragons, haven't you? People talk about dragons and stuff in cultures.
Right.
And that could be translated to dinosaurs.
Yeah.
So, what you're saying...
Go on.
You're not saying it's definitive, but you're saying there was a deluge and that got rid of these animals. And what we're seeing when we're seeing these fossils now given to us by modern science, what we're seeing is these...
The result of the deluge.
These animals that existed before the deluge.
They're not
65 million.
I don't personally think that because it goes hand in hand with the deception of evolution, the Big Bang heliocentrism, making all of the human family insignificant and purposeless. There's no purpose to my existence. Why is there so much? Why is there so much mental illness and addiction to both pharmaceutical prescribed drugs and illegal drugs, and so much unhappiness and misery? That's why, because nobody. Oh, everybody's been taught to believe that there is no God and you're not special and, God's either forgotten about you or he has no power to help your life. Evil has taken over. You are random, you are, floating, well, you're on a rock, you're on a rock that's floating, and there's just no point. Even if you succeed, all your desires... You're gonna die, and you know there's no purpose to it because you'll be. I do agree with that anyway. I don't agree with immortality. This is another big problem that we have with the New Age religion. Everybody's immortal. If everybody's immortal, everybody's automatically immortal. Then there's no need for morality, because you're all gonna go to heaven. So why be good? Well, I'd be good because I feel like you're being good because presumably God's spirit's moving through you. That's why, because you do have a morality, but that morality comes from God. It doesn't come from ourselves, because we see wicked people all about us, don't we? We see people either actually being wicked, and we know the leaders of corporations and bankers and all the rest of it, but people are just going along with the evil, so just going along with whatever the mainstream life is. They've got all the gadgets and the technology, and they're going along with whatever it is.
Yeah, so you believe in a judgmental God then?
100%. Right. 100%, because he has to be. He has to be. He is trying to set up an eternal paradise for those that want to be in it, those that will accept his kingship, basically, his commandments, his judgment. Now, obviously, that involves firstly accepting that, A, there is a God that exists. But the alternative to that, again, is like, it's like I say, it's saying that we're random and we came out of nothing, or say we, that something came out of nothing. Now that is scientifically the most ridiculous thing anybody can say, but those, they hold fast as, I only like science, I don't like religion, but the central tenet of their core is faith-based, that something came out of nothing, that's never ever happened, nobody's ever seen that, something's never ever popped out of nothing in front of anybody on this plane, has it? Not that I know. It's scientifically impossible, unprovable. But those that hold to it don't realise that they are following the faith. In fact, a lot of these things came out of the Kabbalah, the Book of the Zohar, it's a 13th century text, the Big Bang. They will openly, if you have a search for that on the internet, they will openly say, yeah, we thought of the Big Bang and the evolution. Yeah, our religion's right. Every religion wants to be right. God doesn't like religions.
This deception... It's monumental, isn't it? Absolutely.
The no universe one.
Well, it's huge. Everything, all spheres of what we're talking about this evening. It doesn't seem that this deception could be man-made. The deception. I mean, I think we can agree that there are people in the know. When we were talking before about the flat earth or the globe model, there is a small cabal on this planet that actively deceive us, because they know the real truth. And yet, we can't really relate it to normal people, because that is things we do. We don't do that, do we?
We don't deceive people on such a huge scale.
It's not what we do. I mean, we're not, none of us are perfect. We all tell fibs and white lies and everything. But this would suggest that it's gone on for thousands of years, this deception, with people in the know keeping the rest of us in the dark. It would suggest that it would have to be policed beyond belief to keep the secret of the reality.
Mm.
And it would suggest that there is a darker force working within this cabal, as opposed to the God who wants the best for us, really.
Yeah.
But gives us free will to make the judgments.
Or to make the choice, yeah.
To make the choice.
Yeah.
So how do you, what's your take on that then? Have you got any sort of idea of what is this dark force that's running through this cabal? Are these the people that are doing this the same as us? Are they the same genetic code as us? Are they the serpent seed that the Bible talks about?
I don't know. I mean, the Nephilim leading to aliens and all the rest of it to a certain extent there. I think the devil, Satan, Lucifer, which is all the same guy, his ultimate wet dream, his ultimate goal would be for Jesus to return on his appointed time and for not one single human being alive, because the dead are already dead and, you know, their books are finished, if you like, they've done their thing and either chosen or not. But everybody that's alive to make that choice, and for, I suppose everybody going forward, is for every single person to hate the sight, to reject the sight, to fear the sight, to so love the world, to reject the Bible, to reject their own senses, yeah, that the earth is fixed and the sun goes overhead, and not the opposite like we've been indoctrinated to believe, to reject God's love and God's mercy and God's promises. It's about God's promises. God doesn't break promises. We break promises. That's why we've had three new covenants. That's why, we're saying this, that, and the other, and now we're saying this, and which denominations are... That's all Satan's doing. That's all the devil's doing. People go on about, you know, the love, the impure love, and the position of love, and feeling the love from source, yeah, in the heart. And that still holds true, and I've been feeling that for the last couple of years. The only difference now is I recognise the source of that spirit and that love and that energy as the God of the Bible, the God of Jacob, the God of Moses, the God of Jesus. That God. People don't want to give that God a personality. They also don't want to give that God demands or sacrifices, if you like. When I say sacrifices, I'm not talking about the old blood sacrifices and all that. I'm talking about giving up whatever addictions to the world and whatever. You know, if you're working for a vaccination, a company involved in vaccines, and you wake up and you realise what's going on and what's being done and all the rest of it, then quite clearly you have to leave your job. Anybody that carries on doing that in knowledge is... You know what I mean? It is immoral. Sorry, getting back to the question again.
Well, the point is... Who's
running it?
Perhaps that's a question that's hard to answer, who's actually running it. But it seems to me that there's... God is giving... This God that we're trying to talk about, that we're trying to put a name and an image to, which I think is impossible.
Well,
to
yeah.
Because we've no concept of the reality.
That gives us a bit.
But it would appear to me that the flip side of that, that is controlling this plane, or this... it's in control.
It's completely in control.
Right, so... If there is a good God, there is he's trying to work through us to bring about this change, right? And he's giving us free will, but he's also nudging us in the right direction, or trying to.
Yes,
or
yes.
Giving us the word, or giving us people that are giving us the word, yeah. But they're totally ignored. It seems to me, what is the point in that? If God has created this,
right.
How is he allowed?
Why is he allowed evil? It's the problem of evil. Why? How does God allow? God is supposed to be, and it must be within. Although he's not God, right? It's in the job description. Must be all powerful. Must be all loving. All light, I suppose. Yeah, totally, and that's true. Yeah, it's in the description. However, there's evil exists in the world, but. It's right there in chapter 3. we had a choice. We had a choice whether to follow the whether to believe the serpent or not. Now, the serpent, it's funny because the serpent offered Adam and Eve immortality and paradise, I suppose, but they already had it. It's the original snake oil salesman. They already had immortality and paradise, yet they still bought it. That's how, that shows us how easy, it should show us how easily fooled we are. But we still don't learn the lesson. We still have this arrogance about us that we know what morality is. It's this do what thou wilt, although call it, no, do no harm, but do what thou wilt kind of thing. How do we know what we want to do isn't going to cause harm? What made us some kind of eternal, immortal, all-knowledgeable being that we know all the consequences of every single action that we do? That can't possibly be the case, can it? Only a God, or only, you know, some definition of God would be able to do that. And that's why I now put my faith and trust in the Ten Commandments. People going about all the ceremonial laws of the ancient, that's what Jesus got rid of. Yeah, there's no need to go to a temple and do sacrifices and all that. So Jesus became the sacrifice for us. We have a legal problem. If you admit that there are, if you again accept that there's a God, if you admit that there, if you accept that God has a law and you admit that you have committed sins, then you need to pay the penalty for those sins. Otherwise, the law is completely and utterly pointless, isn't it? Yeah, the beauty of God's plan, and this is His infinite love and mercy towards us, is that He gave His Son Jesus Christ. I say Son, it's Him in the flesh, if you like. He became man, yeah, lived a completely blameless life, and took the punishment for our crimes, yeah? So we don't have to be nailed to the cross or give a blood sacrifice or, well, you have to make atonement, you have to repent, you have to do it, and all the rest of it. Change your heart, change who you be, change who you think, yeah? But we don't have to go through it because Jesus already did that for us. Anyway, going back to the law still stands. Many Christians still think now, oh, you don't have to follow the law of Moses, you don't have to do the Ten Commandments, or you don't have to love God and love your... Well, you love God and love your neighbour, but I don't think, it's still okay to commit adultery, or lie, or worship on the wrong day, worship on Sunday, anything that you do unknowingly will be forgiven. God winks at the times of unknowing, and that's true for all. That's
what you're willfully doing. Those
once you know, once you recognise that, oh, I will start. I get it now. We've all got a choice. Mm. We've all got a choice whether to choose God's law and way and eternal kingdom of happiness and joy and no pain and suffering, which is a fair deal to me. Again, with Jesus already paying the price for the punishment of our sins. As long as we accept, and that I accept that we have sinned, that's another arrogance that everybody has, and I certainly had. Everybody has it. What sins? I'm a good person. I try and help the homeless. I try and help, and all the rest of it. And I don't go around, committing serious crimes. I don't go robbing and all the rest of it. Am I a good person? Well, I'll get to heaven. Well, not if you don't believe that God controls everything and God's running the place and it's, No, I don't think so, unfortunately.
So, we'll go back to the flat earth in a bit, but just to sort of tie up a few loose strings here to try and get your general, the way you're thinking.
Yeah.
And it seems to me, and I wouldn't profess to be a Christian or anything, all this sort of information is coming to me at rocket speed. I'm still playing devil's advocate, for a better term.
Yeah.
But it seems to me that the Bible is, as I said before, there's a lot of prophecy in the Bible, and to a certain extent, it would seem like a done deal that light wins, or the good will prevail.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
This dark side doesn't see it that way, as far as I see.
I know.
They don't see it that way. I think they see if they get us in total lockdown. Humanity in total lockdown, the 5th century reality that we're living now.
Yeah.
They can get us in total lockdown, fixated on sex, violence, war, drugs,
fear.
Drinks, the fear. They win, and it would appear to me, and I don't know what you think. Mm. I mean, people talk about the awakening going on.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see it, to be honest. I see some good
what
people
is
doing
the awakening? What is it? Because I, as you quite rightly say, you know, I didn't really see the pattern until you kind of pointed it out, but I'm being vilified for my views on them. And my word is, it's not changed, it's just, there's just a different perspective on it. And I'm talking about for the flat earth just as much as for the Bible and God. But I'm saying follow Jesus, be like Jesus, and Jesus was pretty sinless. There's no stone that anybody can cast against Jesus. You might not believe he was God or the Son of God. People might not believe he existed, but even as a story. But there is no point, and he's, I think, the only character in history that he didn't commit a sin or a crime against anybody. Any time that he was tempted or that he could have or what have you, or executed the judgment that God will, he didn't. He was always the most loving, gracious, merciful teacher, always. So the message of the God is to be like him and to want to be like him, and everybody in heaven, or everybody on the new earth, should I say, will be like him in God's eternal kingdom. So there will be no crime, it will be just ace people all over the place, none of whom are ever out to harm you. They all live in God's grace and glory.
It seems
and
to me that there'll be very few people, as I see it at the minute, that fit that criteria. Even that those that claim to be working in the name of the Lord.
More of them. More of those that are, more of those in the churches, and again, quite clearly said all through the Bible, those that profess to, you know, be for Jesus, if you like, and be for God, and be spreading the word and the gospel. Aren't they spreading false doctrine and the spreading error? And he will say, "I don't know you." It's like, but we cast out devils and demons in your name. I don't know you. Those people that get dressed up and they go to Sunday church and they contribute and this, that, and the other, but they have private sins all the time. They know they commit the sins because they know the Bible. Those that don't know the Bible, and that's most of all in the truth movement and what have you, that's, you know, or didn't, I hope people start reading it. Especially start with Revelation and Daniel, because it's talking about today, it's talking about history that we know today and all that stuff. But, I've lost the thread again.
It's just, the point I was making is that... I
hope you're going to edit those bits out.
I'll do that. The point is... very few people, as I see it, are matching the criteria to come a judgment day.
Yeah.
Will fit the criteria that he's set out for us.
Right. Right?
When we see wrong, no matter how indoctrinated we might have been to believe it was right, we spoke up.
Yeah.
You know, despite the fact that it might affect our livelihoods, our friendships, our family, we still spoke out about what we perceive to be wrong.
Well, we do that now.
I know a whole raft of people that claim to be free thinkers and truth movement who do exactly the opposite, right? And it comes to certain subjects,
yeah.
They even won't touch them, or they'll disagree because it's PC to do it, or it's, you know, and you fall flat on your
face. There are.
Now, the one thing I'll say about you, now, you know, I know this interview is about you, but you book the trend in our sphere of thinking, in as much as you stood by your truth, even though it's alienated you to a great extent.
Yeah.
So, I wanted to finish this little section on you know, your beliefs on in God and the Word. Again, I want to try and pin you down. Who is this cabal,
right,
that's controlling this planet, that is fully aware of the things we've been talking about? And they're the ones that are pulling the strings. Are they, by some quirk of DNA, have the dark that's running through them, this consciousness from Lucifer or whoever, the dark, the opposite of God, that is doing the evil on this plane? What is it? Why is this? Has God created this? Is it a totally separate?
No, God can't create evil. God can allow Satan, if you like, or Lucifer to create evil, for sure, or men to create evil, because we have free choice of doing that as well. God can't create evil. that's why we're going through all of this.
My point to you is that human beings, aren't capable, right, of the evil and creating this matrix, this deceit, this web of deceit that is thousands of years in the making.
Incredibly.
It's almost perfection. You've almost got to admire it. You've almost got to admire Marvel at it.
For sure.
And my point is that I don't think that mankind or human beings are capable of doing it.
I agree with you 100%.
Or would even want to do it.
I agree with you 100%.
I think
I think Lucifer stroke Satan, stroke the devil, stroke the serpent, stroke the great dragon, is absolutely running things. He was an angel in heaven. He was one of God's most high, probably the third most highest angel, I'm not sure, you know.
So what is different?
He got jealous. He was jealous of God. We could understand that, because that's, again, you should be as gods and this thing that we want to be as God and all the rest of it. But imagine, this is before humankind was even created. So God, you've got the magnificence of God, and then you've got all his angels. And everything's brilliant. But Lucifer, so I got, I mean, again, I've imagined, I've put myself in his mode of thinking. How would that be? To be an angel with God, and then to go, actually, no, I want to be the Most High. I want to have all that power and be a creator, and, you know, have all that. Well, you know, where we are now, quite clear. Well, like, he's basically getting us, all of us, not to rebel. He got a third of the angels to rebel, according to the book, and he is and has gotten all of us to rebel. Where we are now in 2015, the Bible is. I mean, even amongst religious people, even amongst Christian and Jewish people, they don't reference the Bible very much. And quite clearly, the modern thinking, whether you're a scientific atheist believer or a New Age truther, it's all non-biblical, it's all anti-biblical. So if there is a devil and if there is a Satan, and his job is to get people to rebel against God and get people to reject him on any level, so either reject his actual word or just reject that he exists in the first place. Hasn't he done an absolutely brilliant job? Hasn't he done a wonderful job of getting the modern world to reject? So whether you're a mainstream follower of BBC One and you believe David Cameron's a nice guy, or whether you know David Cameron's a puppet of the bankster elite, it makes no difference. Right. It also makes no difference whether you believe the earth is flat or round, or whether you believe the earth is flat, round or flat square, or whether there's a firmament or not, or whether the Antarctica is the real, whether there's more landing beyond it, or whether any of these other things, as long as they are distracting you from the one fact that if you want to live with God, you need to be like God. You need to accept that you're not God, and that you've been way less than perfect in God's eyes, according to God's standards. Ask for that forgiveness and ask for the Spirit to, and I'm talking about Jesus Christ or God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to repair, to redeem us to God, to make us whole again, if you like, to get us back to, you know, get us back to the garden, as Joni Mitchell once sang, but in a hippie, you know, Tavistock way, so we don't go.
Still, I'm still trying to nail you down here.
Okay.
I'm trying to pin you down.
Okay.
To this pernicious bloodline, these pernicious bloodlines that have controlled this matrix.
It's the Vatican.
Right.
It's the papal system. A beast in the Bible is not a beast. It's a, for the most part, it's a power. It's a kingdom. It's an empire. And there has only been one empire running all the way through human history, starting in Babylon or Sumeria, or however people want to say it, running through Persia and Egypt, and influencing obviously Israel with its, you know, whenever it was tempted by Baal worship and all the idols and all the rest of it, but Egypt, Greece, and then into Rome. We know, those that have studied it know, that the given history of Roman Empire falling, and then, you know, the barbarians and the Visigoths and the Vikings and all, you know what I mean, the separate European kingdoms, and then them growing into modern Europe. And, you know, that story's not quite true. The Roman Empire never fell. And you can see, whatever level of awareness and perception you are on, you can see that the Roman Empire has not fallen purely from the architecture of Washington, D.C., You have the Roman pagan god of war, Mars, standing right outside the Capitol building.
At the other end of the Capitol building is the Washington Monument, which is a great big obelisk, which is basically Nimrod. And that matches exactly what the one in St. Paul's, St. Peter's in the Vatican. And again, the dome. I mean, the Pantheon, Jefferson's Memorial, Roman amphitheatres, modern football stadium. The comparisons go on. The eagle is used in Rome. It's used in quite clearly in America. The fascists are used in Rome. They're used in Nazi Germany and Italy. They're used in America. They're right there on the House of Representatives. The big fascists used for the national god and the eagle. They combine them both. The Roman Empire never fell. The Vatican is the seat of the seat of Satan, the seat of Lucifer. It controls via the Jesuits all secret societies. Anybody, again, that's done research into the Freemasons and the Illuminati recognises that there is a secret society that most presidents and high-level establishment figures from all over the world seem to belong to. It comes in various guises, it comes in various colours and clothes and uniforms and, you know, slightly different, they vary the symbols and whatever, but it's always the same. You've got a sun symbol right over number 10 Downing Street, you've got a sun symbol for the CIA's logo. Nicholas Copernicus is holding the sun symbol. It's everywhere, right? As soon as you open your eyes, it's like, it's a Donald, it's like those magic eye pictures. Yeah, you kind of just looks like a blur of dots. When you learn to, and you don't stare hard, you do the opposite, you kind of relax your eyes, yeah? And then you see it becomes a 3D picture. And then once you've seen it, it only takes a second to cut, and you can see virtually anyone. And it's the same with this waking up. It's not really, it's a waking up, it's a willingness to, it's an unwillingness to accept dishonesty from ourselves, to accept less than absolute evidence. But having said that, we still do it now, even with the flat earth. We're still doing it now. We're, at least we're not saying, oh, we've got it all, we've got all the answers. Because how many trapdoors are you going to go through until we get to... We're men. We're men and women and not gods. Have I answered your question yet? We're still
not,
going around
that. Not really.
Good man. Excellent. Yeah, keep pushing.
Seems to me that, again, this small clique, these bloodlines, like you say, going back to ancient Sumeria, Babylon, who've worked through all the empires, who've created the empires, who've created the wars, who run the money system. They are aware of the word in the Bible, and they must believe in it, because they're at the antithesis of it. They're creating something that is, you know, completely opposite to it. So they believe in it. But my point is, who are these? Who is this cabal? Are they a separate entity to us? Is there some particular quirk that makes them more amenable to this, being a part of this cabal? Are they born to be part of this cabal? Are they?
Yeah, isn't that the point of the bloodlines? Isn't that the point of families? Isn't that the point of, you know, families and bloodlines, if you like?
Right.
That they are people are born.
So is this the serpent seed then that we're dealing with?
I'm not sure what you mean by that.
Well, it's talked about in the Bible, isn't it? The seed of Satan, the serpents.
Well, I mean, it's Cain and Abel. It's, you know, it's the stories are there. The it's all about God teaching man. It's all it always connects and comes back down to the same thing. But again, you have to.
I see this, and I don't want to detract away from anything you're saying. This is just an opinion.
Yeah.
But I just see that what man is doing, we are being blamed in a way. That we are part of this, that they're the same as us, that we're all just the same, we're all human beings, and we're all culpable. And my point is, it would seem to me that no, that isn't the case.
No, not so quite clear.
It would seem to me that 99%.
I'm not evil, we're not psychopaths.
The 99% that are being manipulated and controlled and have been throughout history, this 1%, to me, for some reason, are totally different. Completely in their way of them, way of thinking, their psychopathic behaviour, their lack of compassion. I can't relate normal humanity to them, and this brings me back to the point that I'm trying to get you to address.
Yeah,
is what are they? Who are they? What, apart from being, you know, doing the work of Lucifer or Satan, what makes them unique, in as much as they can promote this over thousands and thousands of years without, you know, diverting from the path, something that we're just not capable of doing? We can't organise a piss up in a brewery, to put it mildly, you know.
I mean, it proves that we're more than flesh and blood, though, doesn't it? Quite clearly. I mean, where does creativity come from? I saw a great quote today on a YouTube, on a YouTube comment, and I wish I could pull it up, actually, because it basically says something about we were fish and then we grew legs and then we started breaking, eating coconuts. It ended there, and I thought, yeah, and then from then we suddenly became able to create art masterpieces and beautiful symphonies and incredible architecture and technologies that have just, you know, that some have actually helped, some have hindered. But you know what I'm saying, the creativity of humanity, the human brain, it's quite clearly been designed, but there's no monkey men, there's no middle ground, there's no fossil evidence for any species ever having, you know, turned into another species. Sorry, again, I keep wandering away from your central question. Who are they? Are they different to us? Are they, you know, what you're saying, might they be kind of demons made flesh themselves? Maybe?
I don't know. All the evidence seems to point to me that they don't act like us. They don't reason like us. They have no
compassion.
They have no emotions. That's and compassion the same as us. And this has been proven.
We can't get our heads around that.
No.
Because whereas I hear it a lot from people that are still plugged into the mainstream, they're just greedy. They're just incredibly greedy. But I tell you what, just before I woke up, it didn't occur to me. I mean, I was getting more and more of these questions, I suppose, so we all always heading to a point. Why does Richard Branson, for example, why does a billionaire want more and more billions? And he's like, oh, well, you know, he's an entrepreneur, he loves to create services, he wants to make the world a better place and all the rest of it. Well, if that was the case, actually, you wouldn't have one brand, you wouldn't want to be the Virgin brand and all that. And it's the same with whatever brand, I'm not picking on him, it's just because we're British and we can relate a little bit easier. If that was really the case, you just separate it from enough separate services. You take the ego and the personality out of it. So that's certainly involved with it as well. But also, I mean, even if you were quite greedy and you wanted a £500,000 house and a Ferrari and, you know, I'll buy yourself a yacht if you want for 150, whatever, you still only need a couple of £1 million and maybe put £1 million in the bank. That's £3 million. These people have £1 billion, which is £1,000 million. That's £997 million. They can't possibly need, unless they're buying, you know, diamond encrusted slaves or, you know, gold, you know, whatever, you know, gold encrusted carriages and all the, you know, just ridiculous. Again, it comes back to the psychopathy. Why does a billionaire want more and more billions? But they do. And there's all these problems in the world. But they're all philanthropists. They host these dinners and get dressed up and donate. They raise millions. But there's still these problems. I don't get it. It doesn't add up, and it shouldn't add up to any rightful thinking person who stops brushing with fluoride toothpaste, who cares, wants to do something, just because there is love in their heart and compassion for their brothers and sisters.
There's a school of thought, isn't there, that the cabal do philanthropic things. You know, they do good to balance out, because they know that there's a certain reality to karma, and that every action has a reaction. So when they're massacring millions and thousands in their wars and asset stripping, etc., they balance that out.
Right, with
doing things
building
like
a hospital.
Building a hospital or building a school. Because they believe in this karmic idea that you can
balance it out.
You can balance it out.
It's the same with this thing with the Catholic Church, and I wasn't brought up Catholic. And the beauty of the Catholic Church, you know, if you believe that the devil, Satan, you know, if you believe the Bible and Martin Luther, basically, that is the, you know, the Antichrist system, the beast system of the Bible, Daniel and Revelation.
is that it turns, if people grow up Catholic, it turns quite a hell of a lot of people away from the Bible and God. And that's, to be honest with you, the point of most religions. It's really, it's a fine balance. It's the same with the, what we were discussing before, with the politically sensitive topics, we'll call them. And, you know, isn't it a beautiful expose of how Orwellian, you know, doublethink and newspeak and what have you, is just, it exists like never before. We can point to it, it's tangible now. And people still won't see it, you know what I mean? They still won't twig on. Sorry, I digress again. Just wind me back, please.
I don't think we're going to get there. I can understand why we couldn't get there, to be honest, because I don't think it's a question we can answer.
What is the question?
Well, the question is, again, I'll try and get back to it. It's that there's this pernicious 1% who everything they do points to the fact they are completely and utterly different to us.
The brainwashed. We're brainwashed. We're insane.
We can be brainwashed, can't we? But that doesn't mean we would run a banking system. That doesn't mean that we would instigate world war. You know, it doesn't mean that we would create a vaccine to wipe people out. Mm. You know, we can be capable of doing all sorts of nasty things. But I don't think collectively over millennia, we could create.
We have a plan to. Yeah. Control and enslave and distort and deform humanity.
So while I've got you on that, then what makes this 1% different? What is it about them, this 1%, that makes them so different to us?
The realization that they existed and they had a plan and it was in place, or they had several dozen plans and they were operating on all kinds of levels, made me realize that. Yeah, there is a devil, demon entity running things. But that very, very, very quickly, and I know I said, actually, I am contradicting myself and I'm not giving the full story, but maybe I am now. But that realisation that, oh my God, there is pure evil in the world, exactly as you said, these people are psychopathic and all the rest of it, means that there is serious, I mean, we're talking about child sacrifice, Satanism and all the rest of it as well, but Satan really exists. Now, if there's an evil power, if there's an evil demonic spirit, then there must be a God as well. There must be. You can't have one without the other. Yeah? Yeah. An evil spirit would not create what we see today, what we know. You know what I mean? Love wouldn't exist if an evil demon, if the devil had created the world for a petri dish, which I think is what some people are afraid of, isn't it, sometimes? Or it might be aliens or whatever, you know what I mean? We're just a plaything or an experiment for them.
Or we're batteries.
Yeah, as in the Matrix. Well, it's funny because the first waking up, 9/11, New World Order, January 21, feels like, yeah, the Matrix, but the fixed Earth, and then, hang on a minute, evolution and the Big Bang and heliocentrism is rubbish, but they rubbished the Bible. So if they're out the window, is the Bible now true? Is it accurate? Like I said, I want to know, A, are there any more evidences? And we've gone through a few tonight. And B, there, and what else does it say then? You know what I mean? So, you know, the realising the devil, realising that there's therefore a God. It really is that important. It really is that big. It's a battle for your soul. It's a battle for your eternal soul. And like I say, far too many people in the truth movement, and the pervading religion of today, if people aren't specifically religious, is we have an immortal soul, we're temporarily physical, and we're going to go back to the immortal state, and then we'll get to choose what we want to do next. Now, I believed that for, you know, up until recently, for a short time. I was atheist, by the way, before that. Completely atheist, scientific materialist. So these people are trying to school me on the globe Earth and you know how all, you know, I lived with that belief for 40 odd years. We were close there, weren't we?
Were we close? Not far.
Just wind me back just a little bit.
I don't think it can be answered. To, okay. To be honest, it's a bit, and it's a bit unfair to try and to get you to
move on and go on a different tangent.
I think what we'll do now is, if it's all right with you, we'll get back to the flat Earth.
Okay.
Concept, reality, if you like. What would you consider? Because I would thought throughout history up until Copernicus, the general consensus among people on the
on Earth.
I keep saying
that's how it controls the language.
On Earth,
we live in a global community.
Was that
global
it
companies?
It was flat. It was flat. And I mean, I've spoken to people. No, they didn't. No, there is no history or cultures that said the Earth was flat. I've had this said to me by people, very intelligent people. So there are no.
It's easy to check, though, isn't it? This is one of the things that I, you know, to be honest with you, there's a lot to check. The Babylonians thought it was flat. The Egyptians, I think the ancient Egyptians thought it was flat. The newer Egyptians started to think that it was a ball. But that's when the false doctrine came in, because it came via the Greeks through the later Egyptians. Up to the Rome, and then, you know, as we know, through the church and all the rest of it, it seems that even the I don't know the full history. I don't know enough to be able to make some kind of authoritative statement on such things. What was the question on the flat Earth again?
No, it's just I was saying that up until Copernicus, I think the general consensus. I mean, the zeitgeist at the minute says that they were ill-educated, ill-informed,
yes,
and didn't know their arse from their elbow
until Columbus or Magellan.
Right, and so we frown. The zeitgeist frowns upon these ancient.
We think
cultures.
We're so smart and clever.
Yeah.
But we didn't. But we couldn't build the pyramids in the 90s. We couldn't build a half-scale version of the Giza pyramids in the 90s with all the modern technology and engineering, even though we built the Burj Dubai and the Twin Towers. The pyramids were built, I mean, you know, nobody knows, but thousands of years ago without cranes and all the rest of it. And these are huge 100-ton blocks from hundreds of miles away. And Stonehenge, and there's pyramids in China, and Bosnian pyramids underground, and just there's incredible engineering feats from thousands of years ago that tell me that we were far more advanced then than we are now. Mm. We might have digital stuff, we might have the computer chip and the combustion engine. Anything else? The power plant that delivers electricity, and hair dryers and washing machines.
Penicillin.
But, say again.
Penicillin. The combustion engine, yeah.
But we didn't build cities in the mountains like we did in Machu Picchu. So,
well, the drip drip feed.
One
isn't
of
it,
the other
it?
Great lies for me is that we're going backwards, not forwards. Each generation is getting worse. We're getting dumber. We're getting more into this whatever the Orwellian, you know, the Orwellian belief system is. We know what the Orwellian belief system is. It's this whole thing we've talked about. Everything within political correctness, basically, and everything's becoming, you know, uniform. Thoughts are controlled.
So the drip drip feed you're getting on the television programs, yeah. Sky and Discovery, is that these ancient pyramids and stuff were created by, well, we weren't up to it, so it must have been ancient aliens, or, you know, it's. So it makes you know, they talk about they were these ancient cultures, you know, were basically thick, you know, they weren't up to anything. So the idea that
although they could etch and write it down for us,
they believed in a flat Earth, so they were thick.
Yeah.
They couldn't build the pyramids; it was aliens that did it. You know, the reality is somewhat different, as you said. There does seem to be this dumbing down that's taking place. I mean, we've got great stuff, don't get me wrong, we have got good stuff now.
Yeah, but doesn't the stuff that we have help dumb us down? Because we've got Google and not libraries anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas before, when I was a kid, you wanted to know something, you went to a library and you read a book, and you'd learn a whole sort of... I mean, you can do that on the internet as well, but the problem with it is slowly and surely, again, as Orwell
pointed out in the blueprint, not his blueprint, but that, and we can already see with Google, you do Google searches, and they are quite clearly restricted. And they've even openly said they're going to do it according to fact-checking, or whose decision is that? How do we know a fact is true? How do we know a subjective truth is objective truth? We can't know that. We cannot know that. Again, it's another lie, it's another serpent lie, you shall be as gods. You can decide for yourself, you can make your own morality, you can make your own rules and laws. But how do we know that those rules and laws and the actions that we think are allowed by those, how do we know that they aren't going to impact on people? We can't know that. There's only one being that can know that. So why not follow his laws and rules? We don't want to make sacrifices, Alex. That's the bottom line. Is people are loving the world exactly as written and predicted. They love the little addictions, they love the little sins, they love the little, you know what I mean, what have you. We're not willing to make the sacrifices. And nobody's perfect, but we at least need to ask for help in overcoming, you know what I mean? And just the asking for help and the asking for forgiveness and realising that we are not gods and you know, we are basically children of God, is, you know, the biggest step towards it.
And this opens up a can of worms because you're basically admitting, I don't know a lot of it. A lot of it is blind faith, isn't it?
It's not blind faith though.
From the word. You're taking it from the word, but it's faith, but some of it you have to take.
But don't forget the word. I didn't start out life indoctrinating to everyone in the Bible's true, so you must believe it. So I'm not starting from that premise. I'm starting from the premise that if I have enough weight of evidence, I will believe a thing is true. Where's that evidence? Where can that evidence come from? It can come from my own senses first and foremost. Can my senses deceive me? Yes. So will I need to see a thing or experience a thing a few times to believe it? Yes, I will. Yeah. If it happens once, you know, or twice, three times. So, you know what I mean? Certain things have happened every single day of your life.
Your detractors will use that against you, though, won't they? Your detractors will say, especially when it comes to something like the flat earth.
Yeah.
They'll say, well, you don't know. I mean, have you ever been in space? Have you ever seen that the earth's not a globe?
Nobody's ever been in space.
Tell me what's, I mean, you believe in the flat earth. What's beyond
nobody's ever been in space.
When you get to the Antarctic, you know. Yeah. What's beyond this 200-mile barrier that people talk about? What's beyond it?
you're another kind of worm there. Just go back 1 second. What was the first question?
You've never been in space, so you don't know.
Oh yeah, with my own experiences. The two things are, one, I certainly haven't. Have you ever experienced a curving horizon? Have you ever seen the curve of the Earth? I haven't personally. The other personal experience thing is, have you ever felt as if the earth is spinning round? Now, those that have been in an earthquake of, you know, any decent magnitude will know what it's like when the earth really is actually moving. And it, you know, is, I've never been in a big earthquake. I would imagine it's very, very scary. And there was, you know, a few not long ago, New Zealand, quite famously, and buildings collapsing and stuff. Now, I believe that's what would happen if the earth was spinning round all the time. There is no experience of that. So, I haven't seen the earth from space. I haven't seen the edge of the earth. I don't think there is an edge of the earth. I think the map that we are shown, say on Google Earth, if you zoom out, I think that's kind of, although they make Antarctica massive. But basically that flat earth map, that square oblong flat earth map, is pretty much the map of the earth, I think so far. The two things I know is that the world does not spin, it does not move. If it moved, there is a whole load of stuff just underneath the ground that is not glued there and fixed, like animals and oil and rocks and soil and coal and, you know, whatever the bits are, just underneath the surface. If we were tipping over, I know we don't tip over that, but if we're tilted, yeah? If we were spinning around at 800 miles an hour, 700 miles an hour, 1,000 miles an hour, depending where you are, that stuff would make a noise underneath us. It would make a noise. We'd have some experience of it. They have got us. Again, we're talking about brilliant evil deceptions, yeah?
we're talking about far beyond what man can do. They have got us to believe the opposite of what our own senses experience. What we call common sense, what we like to call common sense. Common sense is what we experience and have experienced many, many times before. Like I say, if you experience it once, yeah, your senses can deceive you, everybody knows that. But if you experience it hundreds and hundreds of times, or not hundreds and hundreds of times, then for you it's pretty much the truth. And I defy anybody to say, yes, I have experienced the earth spinning round. The only thing that we have, oh sorry, you haven't experienced that. You have experienced the sun going overhead, yeah, arcing overhead, coming out from the east and over to the west. That gives the illusion of movement. But all you're actually experiencing with your own eyes is the sun starting from over there and going across the sky, or going across the sky from whichever way you're looking at it. We're taught that it's the opposite. No, that's still, and we're moving. But that's the complete opposite of your own senses. You're still, and that's moving. Now, isn't that a superb and brilliant deception? And again, it's reverses and opposites. It goes back to the conservatives give and sell everything away, and the liberals don't want to give you any freedom. And that's how you know Lucifer, Satan's running the world, because he is Mr. Backwards and Mr. Reverse and Mr. You know, we know about, you know, reverse meanings, and they can put things upside down, and you know, your subconscious works it any way. That's what he does.
So if you were to paint a picture from what you know now, or what you believe you know now, or what's resonating with you now.
Yeah, okay.
If you were to paint a picture for people watching this video, completely new to all this, what would be, if you were to be, you were for some reason you were able to be outside of this firmament, okay, looking in, or right, looking at the whole picture, what would it be? Would it be an infinite plane with just a dome over a certain section of it? Would it be a rock in a space with a firmament over it? Would it be a massive Petri dish with a god looking down upon it? If you could give,
the idea of the infinite plane beyond the Antarctica, that the hiding more land and all the rest of it, it opens people up to the same deception as if there's a billion other planets in outer space. They could still do some kind of deception. Oh yeah, we're from beyond the wall, like Game of Thrones and stuff. You know, the blur fiction and reality all the time, until reality becomes fiction and fiction becomes reality. And that sounds like, you know, something people have said for the last 50 years or 100 years or whatever, but it's never more true than today, which is why I say it. And it's how they do it. They get the dream world and reality to collide all the time. The amount of people, I've seen it a few times in flat earth debates, where people have said, I think we went to the moon, but I think there are aliens there, or we somehow got scared off, and that's why we've never been back. And that is pure Hollywood. It's a Hollywood script from a film called, I think it was called The Moon. It was a horror film. And people take it, they've blurred it in their heads, and they know this. They know this. We know Hollywood propaganda, you know, it came out of, you know, it came from the Nazis as well, you know what I mean? Nazis, NASA, and Hollywood propaganda. Telescreen programs. Everything was shown, unless it can be verified. Don't accept it as truth. It's as simple as that. Have more cynicism. People call us cynical all the time. You're cynical about everything. But we're positive. I'm positive because I know God's made a promise. He made a promise to Abraham, and he made a promise to Jacob, and he made a promise to Moses, and he made a promise to Joshua, and he made a promise to the Israelites. And don't get me wrong, sometimes these people have broken the promises, and he's therefore not come through with his side of the bargain, and that's fair enough, isn't it? We go on a lot about the truth movement, about contracts and fair contracts and contract law and bailiffs coming and no contract and all the rest of it. But if you make a contract with somebody, then you've got to keep your part of the bargain and theirs. Now we're talking about a contract with God here. We're talking about the infinite, the wise creator of all, that, you know, whose breath animates every single big creature and being on the plane. So making a deal with God, as Kate Bush once sang about, making a deal with God, or keeping a deal with God, you know, his side of the bargain, his promise is going to be way more than whatever sacrifice we're
being asked to make, and that's different for each person, but we know inside ourselves, like we say, that moral, you know you're doing something that's wrong, you know what I mean?
Your moral compass.
Moral compass, we do have it. But it's not innate, it's learned, and it's learned from God, either by the Spirit or by the Word. It's a really fair deal, because he already sent Jesus to be your sacrifice, to pay the price for your sins, to pay the punishment. You don't have to go to jail, you don't have to do any penance as such. Repent means to turn away. It doesn't mean to just, obviously you ask for forgiveness, like you're saying about, you can't fake it. God knows your heart. God knows every thought that you ever had. And I'm catching myself now I'm going to try and cheat. I mean, you know, like just these really, because it's programming. It's a lifetime of conditional programming from the bad side, from the demon on your shoulder. Everybody's got an angel and a demon on their shoulder. And right now in the modern age, demons are way out shouting the angels. The angels are, you know, they're always there, you know what I mean? Neither can completely die. Even if you're almost completely angel, you've still got a demon there, and he can, and quite clearly you can start listening to him again at any moment, as any lapsed addict would tell you of anything. It's very, very hard to do. But it's the story that I think it's a Red Indian story about the wolves. And which wolf you feed is the one that, you know, is the one that survives. And again, it's simply your better angels, your better nature. Are we going to follow that which we know is right, or are we going to follow that which feels good? Oh, when it feels good, so, you know, it must be okay. The moral code and compass must come from outside of ourselves. Otherwise, we are setting ourselves up as God again. And we're not God. And even the Eastern religions that believe in the reincarnation and karma, and eventually you'll get to the perfect God or the Godhead or whatever, you know, I mean, they're all different, and I know I'm probably misquoting and getting things wrong there, but there's a general thing about, you know, basically achieving that this perfect state of being. Nobody's done it. I haven't come across anybody that's done it yet. Yeah, I know there are 25,000 people currently claiming to be Jesus Christ and be the Messiah and all the rest of it, but, you know, nobody seems to, because if I've got godlike powers, put it this way, right? If I've got if I come across these godlike powers, if I become somehow immortal or reintegrated or whatever, all these things that, you know, telepathic, being able to translocate and do all this, you know, amazing, wonderful, you know, sci-fi stuff, then I'd bring down the bloody government, I'd stop them doing wars, and I'd stop them raping children, I'd bring people to just, I'd do the Superman role that we saw from the, you know, that we all seen from Marvel Comics. But nobody seems to be doing that. That's how I know DC. That nobody has become a godhead, that nobody has become an immortal Avengers superhero god, because they would have got together, even one of them, go and stop Obama, stop drones, stop vaccinations, stop GMOs, stop all this nonsense and poisoning. Well, it's not happening, is it? So nobody has become a god yet. And if nobody's done it in the past, what's the chances of somebody doing it in the future? There is nothing in our genuine perception. There are a lot of alternative truth media, alternative news sites and outlets and stuff that might be claiming it, but there is almost no basis to nearly all of their stories.
Is this coming to a head? Are we coming to the end times? Are we coming to the final conflict then?
Well, the final conflict that people think is later on. That actually comes after 1,000 years, that we don't need to worry about any of it. Well, put it this way, there will be a second resurrection, and you don't really want to be a part of that. You want to be already kind of reigning with Jesus, if you like, for the ensuing 1,000 years. So this the Armageddon thing and this final conflict and all Gog and Magog and stuff, that's after. That's in 1,000 and however many years it is first. you make your choice now and before the day that Jesus comes.
Well, I must be mixing in the wrong circles then, because there's very, very, very few people, if any, that I know that would match the criteria that would be sitting at the side of Jesus, as opposed to having to be here for that final conflict in 1,000 years or whatever.
Because well, no, you will already have made your decision to want to be with and like Jesus and accept his kingship and authority and all the rest of it, yeah? Once you've done that...
Do you know anyone, do you know anyone personally that's fitting, matching that, who's doing that? Or I see lots of people who claim to be Christians but are doing very unchristian things as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, it's very few people.
You know, I must be mixing in the wrong circle because I don't know any, and I'll include myself in that. You know, I don't know anyone who's fitting this bill.
What, who's asked for forgiveness and is trying to repent?
Yeah, and he's doing the right thing, can see...
Well, you're looking at one. I'm not holding myself up as perfect in any way, shape or form. What I'm saying is...
That's why I've got the camera on.
I am trying my best to... I am trying my best to repent, not only for past sins, but to try and be morally like Jesus going forward, and not do any harm. But again, you can't know all the... the arrogance is dissipated because I know I can't do it, because I accept that I can't do it, and I need the Spirit of God and the faith of Jesus Christ to be able to achieve that. So it's not I'm going to be saying I have a chance because I recognise that I can't do it without by myself. It can't be done by deeds, and because I'm this, I belong to a church or this, that, you know what I'm saying. The win, again, it is that simple a deal, if you like, is to accept that, you know, is to have the humility to say, yeah, I ain't God, and no man or woman is, and we all need from a little to a lot, for most of us, a lot of help to be reconciled to God. I'd like to live in that eternal kingdom. This one has shown promise in places, in terms of when people have come together to, you know, in recent times as well, Bottom Moss, and you know, like you mentioned my eviction earlier, and many other times that we've stopped evictions and other, you know, really great things that fell, but that's part of it. Sorry, I've lost the thread.
I'll tell you what I'm getting. I mean, I came initially to do this interview with you because the flat earth thing initially,
right?
You know, because but what I'm getting from you, is yes, that's really interesting.
Yeah.
Yes, there's a lot to look at.
Yeah,
but really, it doesn't matter.
It's not the end of the story.
It's what really matters is this.
Yeah,
and the flat earth. Yeah, look into it.
Yeah.
And it's a massive deception, but it's part of the bigger deception. And unless we wake up to the true reality, which is the word,
yeah,
then we're fucked.
Yeah, you'll sleep forever. You won't be a part of the eternal kingdom. I don't think anybody will disappoint you. Anybody that chooses to make the sacrifice, and like I say, it's just a case of, you know, accepting that you're not perfect, that you don't match up to God's word, and that you need help, etc. That you won't be disappointed in what God promises you. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. God has gone to prepare a place for you, a house of your dreams. And you will live there forever. You will have a piece of land with vineyards and land and what have you, and animals and whatever. I think we'll actually be vegetarians, of course. But you'll have that forever. And I presume we'll have families and friends and all the rest of it. You know what I mean? We don't know all the details. And I've only, obviously, it's been a recent study for me. But that sounds like the kind of place that, you know, when you first get into David Icke or Anonymous or Occupy or Anti-Fracking or wherever it is, I want to live in that world. I want to live in harmony with people who just have pure love and just enjoy and happiness. And there's no pain, there's no suffering, nobody's sick, nobody's diseased, nobody's, you know what I mean, fruit grows everywhere, and, you know, you just get to do what you want, there's no work, there's no taxes to pay, there's no, you know what I'm saying? that kind of world. That is what's promised in the Bible.
But you're going to have to earn it. You're going to have to earn it, aren't
you? Have to
earn
it.
He's not going
to
give it you, is he? I mean, obviously.
He will give it you.
Yeah, if you've earned it, as I see it.
It's not. It's accepting his authority. And, well, accepting that his power, his authority, his grace, his amazingness, because people say, oh, he's a megalomania. This God is a control freak and a megalomania. But if it was a megalomania, then it would have created us without free will. It would have created us robots. It would have created the kind of world, this is the world we live in, but without going through all the rigmarole, there would be none of this. Why bother? Why bother saying, yeah, but if you could, just talk to us. Just talk to us and be horrible. That doesn't happen, does it? We all have choices, we all have quandaries, it's all confusion, it's all, you know what I'm saying? There's mysteries and everything else to go through. You wouldn't bother with it. You wouldn't bother with all this story and Jesus and, you know, and everything else. You just have it horrible. You just have it how people imagine hell all the time if he was some kind of megalomaniac, vicious psychopath. Doesn't make sense. So many things don't make sense until you go, hang on a minute, if there is a devil, it's like that the devil does exist, and he has amazingly and brilliantly and successfully got us all to turn away from God the Creator and his love and mercy. Yeah, and those that see that, those that come to that conclusion through the fixed earth, through, like I say, the evidences and the breadcrumbs and the trails and everything else, archaeology and evidence back that book up and back the word up like nobody's business, but it's up for each person to know, investigate that for themselves. But the fact that, like I say, most of the modern world, in whatever section of society you are, even the religions, they don't promote the good news of that Bible. They will either beat you to death with it, as we know, which is one of the reasons why people reject it, or they will give false error, false doctrine, say you have to do this, or you can do this, or you don't have to follow the law anymore, or you can be saved by good faith, all kinds of just false doctrine. All I can say to people is read it for yourself, only the King James Version as well. Why the King James Version? Again, look for yourself the history of the Bibles, and it goes hand in hand with the false religion. Like I say, investigate for yourself. The fact again that we've been turned against it, it's an icky subject. It's not an icky subject, it's more of a, it can't be, it's not true, because we've had generations of education and indoctrination into Big Bang, heliocentrism and evolution that makes that book and that word and that belief system, that faith, untrue. But if once you've unravelled those, thus no longer disproving the Bible, I'm not saying prove that those prove the Bible are true, but you take those out of the way, well, hang on a minute, those intellectually, scientifically, if you like, evidentially, are the main objections to the Bible. So if those are no longer, if they're proved to be erroneous, false doctrines from, you know, various places, from the Hermetica and from the Book of the Zohar, the Kabbalah, then why not investigate it? If those barriers are out of the way, then hang on a minute, is there any truth in it? Jesus died for my sins and God wants me to live in an eternal kingdom. That sounds like it's worth investigating, surely. Why am I rejecting? Why am I rejecting the free gift of eternal life? God doesn't want me to die. God's wrath will come with tears. God wants everybody to survive. The devil wants everybody to go. The devil knows he is doomed. He's going to live for 1,000 years in, it's called the abyss, but will basically be the earth with nobody on it for him to control and deceive. At the end of 1,000 years, I mentioned there's going to be he's going to deceive everybody again, and there's going to be an Armageddon, but God will finally wipe more. He knows he's doing, but he wants to take as many of humanity with him as he can. And it's a personal choice, an individual choice for each soul, each individual being, whether to choose. So at least investigate for yourself, find out what, because we all think we know, and I certainly thought I knew. The Bible, it's, you know, God's really vengeful and wrathful, and I want to be free, I want to be, you know, I'm moral and all, you know what I mean? It's this arrogant immortality, arrogant assumption of being of automatic immortality, that we don't have to follow a moral code to gain immortality and live with God, which, you know, it doesn't make sense when you put it like that. So I'm assuming, therefore, that you didn't realise the depth of my belief, I suppose, but the depth of my thinking around
it's fair to say,
right? Because it, right?
Not in a bad. That's not a bad thing.
No.
It's not a bad thing. Don't get me wrong. No. It's not a bad thing. But I think we're coming to the end of this now. But
yeah.
I think if there's one message you can give to people. Because I would have thought initially, people watching this video, people that are in our sort of sphere of things anyway, who perhaps are surprised by the turns you've taken, are surprised by certain elements within this truth movement, who, you know, it's like herding cats. I mean, I'm supposedly part of this truth movement, and yet I probably have vilified on a personal
black sheep. You're as black. I mean, being a black sheep being a black sheep in the truth movement. You know what I mean? Being rejected as too alternative by the alternative thinkers and all the rest of it. Is it the truth movement? Because the crux of it to me is I'm after the truth. And like I said earlier, I don't want to belong to any group or what have you. I'll associate with anybody, any group, you know, and all the rest of it, if they've got the right attitude and the right intentions and everything else. But I'm after truth, and I don't care where it leads, and that's the bottom line. And that's another thing that's always come all the way through my life, as well as wanting to be, as well as being interested in social justice and the underdog, and you know, helping the, you know, why the poor and why people are oppressed and all the rest of it. That's also gone through my life as well. Always been the philosophical questions. I've always been there. Where were we again?
I'd say we're finishing up. So
good.
Don't worry, be edited down. It won't be 2 hours. But there must be like I suppose a final message for people. Like I say, that initially be watching this video, that will be in this movement for people that are seeking truth, or you know, answers to the way we're living now, and the horror that we're seeing on this on this plane. And you've offered your take on it. Instead of you've gone a complete dichotomy in a way to what the vast majority would have done. Because they would be rejecting this. Is part of the old control structure.
Religion is. I don't doubt that religion is. People can't seem to separate it, and then maybe that's where I have. Religions are control mechanisms. They are man-made organisations, distortions of spiritual truths and teachings from God and all the rest of it. And they're owned and controlled by Satan and Lucifer. All of them. All of them. There is no God's chosen people. There are only people that choose God, and they're from all nations and tongues and kindreds. If you are truly a truth seeker, if you say you're part of the truth movement, then don't get fixated on any particular thing, whether it's how 9/11 came about, who shot JFK, how exactly they staged the moon landings, you know, whether Stanley Kubrick directed them, is the earth, you know, this way or that way, or when I say don't get fixated, don't accept that you've got absolute truth until you've experienced it, say, you know, 1,000 times or 100 times. You know, you've gone outside every day of your life and experienced that the earth is not moving. That's how I know the earth is not moving. Everything else is up for grabs. And everything else we've been taught and we've been indoctrinated with, and that might be a religious indoctrination for some people. So wrong interpretations of the Bible. I'll give you just one example right there in Genesis. God created the earth in 6 days, and on the seventh he rested. On the seventh he rested. Now, we get the Roman and the Julian calendar anyway, because they're all, you know what I mean, we should be following the moon, the phase of the moon. But
most Christians worship on a Sunday. Now, the Sunday is the first day of the week, not the seventh. They are completely disobeying the... And he goes on about the Sabbath a lot in the Bible as a memorial to creation. Again, it's, you know, it's who you're going to worship. It's down to this. The final message is this. Who are you going to worship? Because the bottom line is this. As far as the God of the Bible is concerned, the God of Jacob and Moses and Jesus, the God who seems to have created everything exactly as he said in 6 days and a fixed earth and all the rest of all the truths that we're now coming to life. If you're not worshipping God, when I say worshipping him as in following his commandments and praising him and recognising he is the creator, then you are worshipping Satan. And even if you think you're atheist or you think you're this or you think you're that or you think you're an Orthodox Jew or a Buddhist or a pagan, or it doesn't matter what it is. If you're rejecting the God of the Bible, as far as the God of the Bible is concerned, you are taking the mark of the beast. You are following, you know, you are following the other guy, Satan, Lucifer, etc. And the, you know, like I say, that's not me saying it. Yeah, I'm not making that judgment. That's what he says. So if you believe you're spiritual or religious, or you're going to heaven, but you don't believe that the God of Jesus and Bible and the Holy Word is true, or you don't pay attention to it, then you are kidding yourself, and that's his message.
And I can respect that, because I respect people. Well, I can't say people, but I respect the finality of that. You know, right. There's no prevaricating.
Huh?
You either do it or you don't. The option's there for you.
I want laws and rules like that. I don't want to be flimmy flammied and go, well, it was right yesterday. Is it not right today? Because that's exactly what governments do, and that's, like, you know what I mean? They move the goalposts and all the rest. Or you can be arrested in one borough for singing Stick Your New World Order Up Your Arse, where it's perfectly fine in another borough. You want consistency, you want definite black and whites, you want some... These are the rules. If you follow them, you will have eternal life and have eternal happiness and all the rest of it. And if you don't, even one of them, you follow the one, you know what I mean? It doesn't matter which one, you've got to follow them all. If you don't, then you can't live with... Because we can't... If you're trying to create a perfect paradise for all of your children, then you can't have even one of them break the rules, because that will break the paradise. Every single one in that paradise has to understand innately from the bottom of the heart, from morning till night, that there are these are the laws with which got everybody, which make it a paradise. So nobody would even, you know, you go, those that want it, those that choose, are going to live in a world where nobody would even dream of breaking that covenant, of breaking that paradise for everybody, spoiling it for everybody. I think you will feel it. We'll be so connected with each other. And the experiences of mortal man that we all experience, we can't begin to imagine what it would be like. But I guarantee we won't be disappointed. I really don't think we're going to be disappointed. And like I said, how do you know that? How do you know the Bible's true? Because everything that's prophesied so far has come true. And we're talking up to the end, the temporary end of the papacy in 1798, and then it being restored in 1929, and then eight popes coming along. And then we're talking about the cashless system that no man might buy or sell. There's no way John in the first century AD could have imagined computer chips and a digital electronic system and iPhones and, you know, and debit cards and all the rest of it, whether we're just using little bits of silver coin or whatever they were using. Yeah, everything's come true. We can see the rest coming true right now. So why wouldn't you pay attention to it? You know, instead of whatever crap's on the telly, your football and your X Factor and your Strictly Come Dancing and your sexual titillation. Why wouldn't you pay attention to something that may promise you for free, for just a change of heart, a change of attitude, eternal life, eternal life of happiness?
And on that bombshell, I think we'll call it quits.
Did you enjoy that?
Thanks very much, Darren. Cheers. Thank you.
Oh, God.
Enjoy that, yeah.
I still think I did better stuff before you were recording.